who were 20 and under saw the Red Sea open. And now they've witnessed the Jordan River actually, what you might say, stopped up or backed up, dammed up. And so they're going to enter in, and now they face Jericho. And so God has instructed Joshua in verses 1 through 7. Now in verse 8 it says, "And it came to pass, when Joshua had spoken unto the people, that the seven priests bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns passed on before the Lord and blew with the trumpets, and the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. And the armed men," these are men of war, "the armed men went before the priests that blew with the trumpets, and the rearward came after the ark," the pressed ark of the covenant, "the priests going on and blowing with the trumpets. And Joshua had commanded the people, saying, ye shall not shout." Now this is the verse I want you to look at. Joshua said, "Ye shall not shout, nor make any noise with your voice, neither say any word, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout, then ye shall shout." Okay? "So the ark of the Lord compassed the city, going about it once, and they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord, and seven priests bearing seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord went on continually and blew with the trumpets, and the armed men which went before them, but the rearward came after the ark of the Lord, the priests going on and blowing with the trumpets. And the second day they compassed the city once and returned into the camp, so they did 6 days." So this went on for 6 days. 6 days they went around the city, they blew the ram's horns one time, nobody talking, nobody saying anything, and the armed men leading the way. Then you got the priests with the ram's horns, you got the Ark of the Covenant, and they're marching around. And so here on the seventh day, verse 15, "And it came to pass on the seventh day that they arose early about the dawning of the day and compassed the city after the same manner 7 times. Only on that day they compassed the city 7 times. And it came to pass at the seventh time, when the priest blew with the trumpet, Joshua said unto the people," what did he say? "Shout, for the Lord hath given you the city, and this city shall be accursed, even it," and notice now, "and all that are therein to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all that are in her, that are with her in the house, because she have hid the messengers that we sent. And ye," listen now, "and ye in any wise keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest ye make yourselves accursed when ye take of the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble in. But all the silver and gold and vessels of brass and iron are consecrated unto the Lord, they shall come into the treasury of the Lord." So the people shouted when the priests blew with the trumpets, and it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, and the wall did what? Say it. Fell down flat. I said, often important you understand that. It fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man, what's the next word? Straight before him. And they took the city, and they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman and child, young and old, and oxen, sheep, ass, with the edge of the sword. Now, I think most of you know here the Battle of Jericho, and there's been a lot preached about it, said about it. I don't want to bore you by repeating what you already know or whatever. But you know, sometimes repetition can be a blessing. Amen. I found out I don't have any trouble getting blessed with the Ark of Noah. I don't have any trouble being blessed with David killing Goliath. I know all the stories. So stories like this still bless my heart, encourage me. You know that? But there's always some things with some of these stories that sometimes we go back and read them, and we say, and there's another thought in there. There's other messages in there. There's other things that we look at in there. Things that if we were to examine, if we were there to examine that, would make a difference in us. And so the conquering of Jericho was a miraculous miracle of God. Now, not just the walls coming down, but everybody hushing up. I promise you, it probably wasn't a Baptist church. Okay? And so it required, listen, it required the simple obedience of God's people. And the Bible says in verse 1 of chapter 6 that Jericho was straitly shut up. And what that means is that Jericho was sealed and there was no one going in and no one coming out. Jericho had heard about the God of Israel, what had happened to Egypt, and the Canaanites went in there, and other tribes were in there. Everything about Jericho was wicked. It was one of the most wicked, vile cities of that day and time. Prostitution, homosexuality, human beings having sex with animals. I mean, everything, they sacrificed their children to pagan gods. And so every vile thing that you could think of went on in Jericho. That's why God said, kill everything. Kill all the animals, you kill the babies, you kill the women, you kill them all. Now you say, that sounds very cruel. No, it's not very cruel. You see, God knew that if they spared, what could happen? And they had, in other words, Rahab heard. What Rahab do? She believed, didn't she? She said, listen, we've heard about your God. And she, listen, she put her faith in the God of Israel. So they could have done the very same thing. So it wasn't like they didn't know about the God of Israel. And so the Bible says it's a terrible thing. It's an awful thing to fall in the hands of an angry God. And so God said, I want you to do this. And they had to obey the Lord. And so in verse 2, Joshua hears from God. And notice, if you go back and look what it says in verse 2, it says, and the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. God, in other words, God has said, it's yours. In other words, God is saying to Joshua, the victory is just waiting on you. And so, boy, so Joshua announces this victory. This victory would come, but it would require some important timing. Matter of fact, I almost named tonight's message, timing is important. And it is, amen? Now here's why. There's a time to listen up, and there's a time to shut up, and there's a time to speak up. So timing is very important. And so before Joshua, listen, I wrote this down. Before Jericho could be conquered, they would have to conquer themselves. You know why a lot of Christians don't ever win the victory? Am I on or off? I'm on? Okay. A lot of Christians don't win the victory in life against the things that oppose them. It's because they've not learned to conquer themselves. There'll be no conquering Jericho until they conquer themselves. Now, they've seen what God has done. Some saw the work in Egypt, and all that were there came over the Jordan River on dry ground again. And so here we find that if they'll just obey God and do what God says and conquer yourselves, by that I mean die to yourself, believe what God says. So the first thing they had to do, they had to listen up. They had to listen. And so God spoke to Joshua, just like he spoke to Moses. And now he's instructed Joshua what they are to do. And so here's God's man. And so God's man is going to deliver the message to God's people. Now think about that. God's man with God's word to God's people. What does that sound like? Sound like some preaching, doesn't it? God's word by God's man to God's people. Now, I thought about this. There's a time to listen up. When is that, Brother Baker? Every day. Every day of your life, you need to listen up. You need to listen to what God has to say to you. Now, how do we do that, Brother Baker? Let me give you three simple ways. First of all, God has voices today.
Now, I don't mean dreams and visions, but God has voices that we know are real. Number one, the voice of the scripture. Amen? Is not this the word of God? Matter of fact, every word in it is inspired. Holy men of God spake as it were moved by the Holy Ghost. So we have, though it's written, it is the voice of God. And so listen to what the word of God says. And you're not going to be able to listen to it if you don't open it up. You'll be surprised at how many people who are of God's people who are saved seldom read their Bible. About the only time they open their Bible, if they come to church, is when the preacher says, open your Bible. And then they have a hard time finding where he's at, because they don't ever open their Bible. In other words, listen up. The God's voice, that's an upward voice. It's, in other words, set your affections on things above. How can you do that? With the word of God. And so it's an upward voice. Oh, I'm glad this morning or tonight that each and every day you get up, you ought to read your Bible. I don't know how much you can read or should read. I was going to tell you this. If you don't listen up, you'll never have many victories in your life as a child of God. You'll never know the closeness of God and the sweetness of God. Listen, you know, you get used to some people's voice, don't you? You know, the voice of your wife or your husband or your children, mom or dad, the voices. You know, I'm glad, though it does not speak to me with an audible tongue, it does speak to me with that upward voice, that heavenly voice coming from heaven. Boy, the times in my life that I've had some things I had to deal with, decisions to make, circumstances, problems, all kinds of situations, I'm glad that through the years, God has directed me to a portion of scripture that would help me when I deal with that day. So here we find the folks in Joshua's day had to listen up. So the first voice is the voice of the scriptures. That's the upward voice. The second voice is the voice of the Holy Spirit. We have that today. That's the inward voice. Amen? You believe in the Holy Spirit, don't you? Holy Ghost, whatever you want, Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost, they're the same. And so we have that second voice, and that's the voice of the Holy Spirit on the inside. How does he speak? Well, he's not going to speak to you audibly, okay? Now, God spoke to Joshua audibly. He heard him. Now, the Holy Spirit of God will speak. The Holy Spirit will speak to your inward spirit. He will speak to you, and he'll nudge you, and he'll direct you. He says, Brother Becker, that sounds strange to me. It's not. Once you let him listen to you, once you listen to him, once you get in his presence, once you open that Bible up and read that Bible and let that, and you get that upward voice speaking to you, because that upward voice and that inward voice are the same. The upward voice is, of the Holy, of the scriptures, the Bible says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled where? In heaven. So we have the heavenly voice, upward voice, and we have the inward voice, the Holy Spirit in us. And the problem is, a lot of people don't know the voice of the Holy Spirit because he's not in them. They profess to be saved, but when you talk about the Holy Spirit, they say, oh, he is that one, and he's the one that can help you. Before, when I first got saved, I knew about the Holy Spirit, not much. I just knew I just knew about him. But the longer I read the Word of God and began to study the Word of God, the more the Holy Spirit became real to me. And he would nudge me and speak to me and direct me. Somebody says, well, that's your conscience. No, it's not your conscience. I had a conscience before I got saved. Okay? The conscience, it's good to have a conscience, but a good conscience won't get you to heaven. Amen. But I'll tell you what, it's greater than your conscience. It's God in you, and God speaking to you. It's that one when you're doing right, he said, I like that. It's when you serve God and you've done right, and that inward voice says, boy, that's a good, and you say, boy, I enjoy doing that. And the Lord nudges your heart, and you say, thank you, Lord, let me do that. And then when you do bad, it's not, Holy Spirit says, you shouldn't have said that. Listen, I'll tell you how you can tell the Holy Spirit. Before you got saved, you could do some things, really some real things didn't bother you unless you got caught. Then it bothered you because you got caught. But after you got saved, you did some things, and it bothered you. You know what made the difference? That Holy Spirit. And even today, he works that way. So listen up to the scriptures. Read them every day. Let them direct your life. Allow the Holy Spirit to fill your life. The fullness of the Holy Spirit can be yours. And then the other voice, the time to listen up, is the preachers of God, the men of God. That's the outward voice. That's me preaching to you. That's your Sunday school teacher teaching you. Can I say there's some more preachers that you need to listen to? Not necessarily from the pulpit. That's the main one, the men of God. I got news for you. Every one of you men sitting here who have families, you're a preacher. Matter of fact, you represent the high priest in your home. Now take that home and think about it for a while. The husband represents that high priest in the home. You're there. You're to be the spiritual leader. You're to be the one that directs that home and loves that wife like Christ loved the church and helps her and assists her. And it's a team. It's not her and him and them. It's a unit there. But that husband is the one there. And the wife, the Bible says over there in Ephesians, says, be subject one to another. There'll be times the wife will be right and the husband may have to take a back seat. Not positionally, but just in spiritual matters. If the wife has been saved a long time, the husband just got saved, she'll know more than him, but she will not let that usurp authority over him. And so you have the outward voice, the men of God preaching from the pulpit. That's why preaching is so important. You know why we don't have much preaching today in the average church? Because the devil knows what preaching to do. So he gets preachers sidetracked. I was listening to the radio today, and I forget what Christian station it was on. I just happened to find it. I was picking up the kids at school, and she found this in this church down in Charleston, Cathedral of Praise. That's the name of the church. Well, they announced it, so I can say it. Amen. They make it public, I can make it public. Amen. They're having comedy night at their church now. Got this big comedian coming in, and of course you got to buy a ticket to get in. So they're taking the pulpit platform and turning it into a comedy club. And folks by the hundreds will pack that place out. I mean, they'll fill it up. They will have no trouble filling it up. But you say, tomorrow night, someone's going to be here to preach. You might get a handful there. What am I saying? I'm saying that the preaching of the day has no touch of God in it, very little of it. But you need good preaching. You need preaching from the man of God who prays and studies the Word of God that can help you and help guide you, not be a dictator, but an under-shepherd who knows when to reprove, rebuke, and exhort when it's necessary. So time to listen up. So when your preacher gets up and says, take your Bible and turn to so-and-so, take your Bible, turn there, and say, preacher, preach to me. Tell me what I need to do. Show me, preacher. Help me, preacher. Don't come to church with attitude, well, I wonder who he's going to pick out today. No. Your preacher sometimes has to reprove, rebuke. Two of the three is negative. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort. You know what's going on today? Exhort, 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 exhort. No reproving, no rebuking. Live like you want to. Go where you want to go. Live like you want to. It's all right, but it's not all right. It's not all right. And so, listen up. You'll be surprised what God will nudge you about. There'll be things that God will speak to you about that you can share with your pastor. Hey, preacher, man, I read my Bible this week and prayed, and the Lord showed me this, or let me see this, and I want to share it with you. And that, hey, when a preacher hears that, that blesses his heart. Or you see somebody else, you say, I was reading my Bible this week or yesterday, and I read this. Well, I'm telling you, this really helped me. Or I went to in Sunday school. Boy, I've had several folks come to me and say, Brother Baker, the Sunday school class, Brother Denny's been doing a great job. And some of you don't even come to Sunday school anymore. Oh, listen to me. You need to listen up. Well, I probably spent too much time on that, but here we go. Number two. Oh, boy. There's a time to be silent. There's a time to shut up. Well, where's that at, Brother Baker? Well, it's right here in the Bible. Verse 10. Ye shall not shout nor make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout, then shall ye shout. Ooh. There is a time to shut up. When I use that word, I don't mean that in a mean way, just a way of making it plain to you. I could say there's a time to be silent, okay? But I just want to tell you there's a time to shut up. There's a time for the preacher to be silent. When's that time? When God is speaking to me, when I'm reading his word and I'm praying and he's speaking to me through his word and through the Holy Spirit. You know, sometimes not every church service is going to be a shouting service. A lot of folks, they get caught up. And I love shouting service. I love shouting. I love praising God. You know I love it because that's what I do a lot of that. But there are times God will send a holy hush in a service. There are times that God will say, this is not going to be a shouting service. There is a time to be silent. The Bible says, be still, be still, be still, and know that I am what? God. Be still. 1 Thessalonians 4:11, listen to this. And that ye study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we have commanded you. Study to be quiet. Wow. Study to be quiet. What that means is, that word study means you make it a point. You listen. Study to be quiet. There's a time just to hush up. I thought about this matter of silence. And these simple things came to me. The silence of obedience. The silence of obedience. Now, here they are. They're out in that desert. And Joshua said, here's what God says. We are not, when we are going around that thing, we are not to say a word. No noise, no nothing until you get the word. Complete silence. Now think about that. The silence of obedience. So when God says be quiet, just be quiet. When God says listen up, just listen up. Because God wants to tell you something and show you something. And so the silence of obedience. I thought about this. The silence of humility. God has instructed us to do this. Your humility comes when you realize that what you're facing is way bigger than you, and God's going to have to do it, and you humble yourself before God. So here they are. God has said, I want you to be quiet. There's to be no talk, no noise whatsoever. Do you understand? Yes, we understand. And you humble yourself and say, listen, we're in the presence of God. We're going to do this. The silence of humbleness, humility, and then the silence of patience. Oh boy. Now to be quiet, you gotta be patient. First day, here they go. They line up and they're going around Jericho. One time, the trumpets will blow one time, and they go, nobody's talking. And they go, patience. Here's one guy wanting to say something. Here's a guy wanting to say something. Somebody said, Patience, patience. Hey, how much patience you got? Got any? You know what patience means? Godly patience is just waiting on to hear from God. And he won't keep you waiting long sometimes because he's got a Bible. He's got a Holy Spirit, and he's got preachers and teachers for you. Then I thought about this, the silence of fear. Well, preachers fear, the silence of fear. I came across this about fear. And boy, it just intrigued me. Do you think these men were really brave? You think they said, let's go get them? Some may have. But I promise you, there was probably a lot of fear in this camp. You know, sometimes nothing wrong with fear. Now, here's why. This is what I came across. God never intends that we should never fear. We are to fear, listen now, and distrust ourselves. We're to fear and distrust ourselves. We're to put no confidence in the flesh, the Bible says. So we are to fear and distrust ourselves. We are to fear danger as something beyond our strength. Fear something beyond your strength. Well, listen to this statement. But our fear should drive us to Him who has no fear and is able to encourage us in our fear. So when you have a fearful situation like they had, your fear makes you realize, I can't do this. But it drives you to one who has no fear. And He can give you the courage to overcome your fear. So there's nothing wrong with having fear in your life as long as you point it in the right direction. It's a fearful situation. And so the silence of fear. And then the silence of expectation. They're marching around. Some are fearful. Some are getting impatient. They're marching around. But you know, in that crowd could have been some folks who were, even though they couldn't say it, they had a little bounce in their step. And they're looking at Jericho. Boy, you wait till God gets through with them. Oh, we're going to march around 7 days. They just don't know what's coming. I can't wait. I just can't wait what God's going to do. Expectation. And that's where we should live. The silence of expectation. When God comes to us and says, you listen up. Now you listen. Be quiet. And let me take care of this. And you live with an expectation. God's going to take care of this. God's going to see me through this. God saved me. And God's done this in my life. And God's done that. I've read the Bible. He has spoken to me. And so the silence of expectation. God is going to come through. Amen? And He will come through. The Apostle Paul was beheaded, but where did he go? He went to heaven. What's wrong with going to heaven? Now, if I'd have been God, of course I'm not God, I'd have let Paul live a whole lot longer, but that's God's business, not mine. And so the silence of fear and then expectation. You can't wait. And then last of all now, they were given the instructions on when to shout, when to blow the ram's horn. Now, they said you could do it one time each day and then seven times on the seventh day. So here's my third point. There's a time to speak up, or there's a time to shout. There's a time to speak up. The seven priests with the ram's horns or trumpets. Over the book of Numbers, in chapter number 26, we're told there that there's close to 600,000 men that can do battle in the Israeli camp, Hebrew camp. 600,000. So here they go. 600,000 marching around Jericho. And you got the trumpets, you got the priest. They're told what to blow, when to blow, how to blow, and then they're to shout. There's a time to shout. Amen? Oh, boy. And when I looked at this, I thought, boy, I'm glad there's some shouting in here, aren't you? And so blow the shofar. That's the trumpet. This was the ram's horn. Now, the shofar trumpet, every ram's horn had a different sound to it. And the different trumpets, the different horns, gave a different message. The shofar, the ram's horn speaking of here, is the one, it was the trumpet of Jubilee. It was the trumpet of celebration. It was the trumpet of festivity. So God is saying to them, for 40 years you've been in that stinking desert. You have crossed over into a land of milk and honey. It's Jubilee time. And before you can do that, we're going to have to take care of this. And so they said, I want you to blow those trumpets that sound for Jubilee. Victory is coming. Amen. It's sort of like the Calvary blowing the trumpet. Here we come. And so they march around seven times. That's the number of completeness. And they blow seven times, the number of completeness. And the Bible says that the walls of Jericho fell down what? Flat. Flat. What does that mean, Brother Baker? That when those walls fail, usually if a wall falls, it'll be sort of stacked up. But Brother Tommy, the picture is this, that when those walls fail, they fail and spread out. They had not... Notice how they walked straight in from where they were. There was no ladders needed. They walked right in and conquered that city. Didn't have to shoot one cannonball. Wasn't no cannonballs back then anyway, was it? Put it this way. The walls came down. 600,000 came into Jericho. You see, there's one thing about this. Jericho was shut tightly up, but you can't shut God out when he wants in. Amen? And so they were able to witness what only God could. Now, here's some things that I just want to share with you real quickly. Can you imagine the folks in Jericho as they looked out there the first day? And they see that army marching around. Then they go back to camp, and so probably every day they say, well, you know, they had it again. They're just trying to scare us. Well, that's 600,000. We got walls 30 feet thick. These walls are so big and so strong that we build houses on top of them. We got all the water we need, all the food we need, and we're going to party. We're not worried about anything. Hey, their God might have took care of Egypt, but, boy, we better in Egypt. Every day. Finally, after a while, the folks in Jericho probably thought, well, one more time, but then the walls came down and they were destroyed completely. You know what happens when you listen up and when you hush up and you shut up? God will help you speak up. God will make a good witness out of you. And God will make a good testimony out of you. There's a time to do all these three. So timing is important, and here it is. So listen up every day. Listen up. Get your Bible out. Let God speak to you. Talk to the Holy Spirit because he is a real person. You talk to him just like you talk to anybody you want to talk to. I talk to the Holy Spirit every day and throughout the day. I do. And sometimes I talk to him. I say, Holy Spirit, well, I got to go to Charleston. There's 25 stoplights between me and Charleston. Holy Spirit, would you work it out where I just can get down there pretty quick? And I'm telling you, there's been many times every stoplight be green. And you know what, Brother Victor? There's been time I say, Holy Spirit, I need that again. And then the first light be red, then the second, and the Holy Spirit say, not today. But you know what I found out, Brother Tommy? It might be a reason for not today. It might be a reason for every light to be red instead of green. So I talked to him. I just talked to him. You talk to your wife? You talk to your children? When's the last time you talked? So listen up. Read it. Listen to him. Listen to preaching. Listen. And then as he speaks, you just be quiet. You know what's wrong with most people when people are talking? You know what's wrong with most people? They're not listening to you. They're waiting for you to hush up so they can tell you what they want to tell you. I've done this on a few occasions. I'd be talking to somebody. I know they. I said, what do you think? What? What I just said? Oh. Or you'd be talking to somebody and they're looking for a place to jump in so they can tell you about what things on their mind. That's the way Christians are with God sometimes. Listen, you let God do the talking, you do the listening. He'll let you shout. He'll let you do some talking. Amen. Can you imagine when they shouted and the walls fell down? Oh, I mean, just fell down. They said, I can see them now. Wow! Look at that! Let's go get them. And they wouldn't got them. Amen. So I hope tonight, this little simple but profound message on these three thoughts will help you as a child of God, will encourage you that you can have victory on top of victory if you just learn to listen up, shut up, and then speak up. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you now for this time together in church. I pray, Holy Spirit, that what you've given me tonight to give to them will encourage and help them, Lord, in their day-to-day living. And God, the Bible will become real to them. The Holy Spirit will be real to them. And Lord, they'll live day by day in victory in the things of God. In thy name I pray. Amen and amen. Let's stand to our feet. We don't have a pianist. You just come on and pray if you need to. Lord Jesus, help us tonight for these few moments together. Maybe somebody needs to come pray about something, Lord. I pray they'll come. Please, Holy Spirit. Have your way. Watch over us tonight, tomorrow. Oh, dear God. We sure need to hear your voice every day. Every day, hear your voice. And we can. And Lord, your voice should never be strange to us. Lord, you tell us that your sheep will know your voice. And so, Lord, I thank you for that still, small voice of the Holy Spirit. And then sometimes it's the bold, loud voice of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the scriptures. Thank you, dear God, for preachers that have helped us over the years. Please bless us now as we dismiss and head our ways, dear God. In thy name we pray, amen and amen. All right, God bless you. You're dismissed. Keep playing. Amen. Praise the Lord.